Hi, this is Electronix. In this video, I'm going to build an audio amplifier circuit with TDA2030A, TIP41C and TIP42C on the breadboard. Before the video starts, be sure to subscribe and click the bell for notifications. If you've been looking at the TDA2030A datasheet, you might have seen this diagram which shows the TDA2030A combined with two transistors to handle the higher output currents for the 4 ohm speakers. If you examine this diagram, you can notice that this design is made for single rail power supply, so a high value capacitor is required at the output to block the DC current going to the speakers. Placing a capacitor in the signal path, even at the output, can decrease the quality, moreover, cuts off some of the low frequency range. I came up with the idea to make a circuit on the breadboard based on this diagram with the components that I have that use a split power supply, which is more preferable in audio amplifier circuits. This diagram was made in EasyEDA, which is a really good and easy to use free circuit and PCB designing software. Compared to the original schematic, I've tried to use lower resistance values to keep the noise down. At the input, I've used higher value input DC decoupling capacitor for better low frequency range. Let's build this circuit on the breadboard. The TDA2030A and the transistors are already placed on the breadboard. This is the pin order. On the left you can see the schematic representation of the transistors with the pin numbers. The pin extensions of the TDA are placed intentionally this way, so it will be easier to connect it to the transistors. The power supply includes a dual rail 12V transformer with 100V power rating. Unfortunately, I don't think this transformer can handle that much of power. The transformer is connected to a diode bridge and two 3300 microfarad capacitors to create the required stable dual rail supply voltage. Now comes the list of the components. Two pieces of 220 nF CBB polypropylene capacitors. Two pieces of 1.5 ohm metallized film resistors. 10 microfarad electrolytic capacitor, which later will be changed and tested with other values. 2.2 microfarad bipolar capacitor, which will be tested with other values. Two pieces of 1N4007 diodes. Two pieces of 22k ohm and one piece of 1k ohm metallized film resistors. Later I will change and add more components to achieve higher output power and better frequency range and response, but first the simple circuit will be built. Let's start building the circuit. The first component placed is the 2.2 microfarad bipolar capacitor. One end will be connected to the signal input, the other one is connected to the pin 1 of the TDA2030A. You may have noticed that on the schematic it is shown 4.7 microfarad. Later I will use that value, but first, for testing, lower value capacitor is used. The next component is a 22k ohm metallized resistor between the pin 1 and the input ground. Another 22k ohm resistor is placed between the pin 2 and 4, which is part of the resistor pair which sets the gain of the amplifier. The second part of the gain setting resistor pair is the 1k ohm resistor, which is connected to the pin 2 of the amplifier IC. To the other end of the 1k ohm resistor, the 10 microfarad capacitor is connected with the positive lead. The negative lead of the capacitor is connected to the signal ground. I place a wire to the pin 4 of the TDA2030A, which is the output pin. To the other end of the wire, a 220 nF CBB capacitor is placed, which is used to cut off high frequency sounds which are out of the hearing range. The other leg of the capacitor is connected with a wire to the ground line. Notice that the schematic shows a resistor in series with the capacitor. For testing, it will be left out and placed in the circuit later. The next component is the 1.5 ohm half watt metallized resistor placed between the pin 1 and 3 of the TIP41C transistor. Probably you've guessed the next component, it is a resistor with the same values, this time it is connected to the pin 1 and 3 of the TIP42C. Another 220 nanofarad CBB capacitor is placed between the pin 1 of the both transistors. With the yellow cable, I connect the capacitor between the two transistors. A 1N4007 diode is placed between the pin 2 and 3 of the TIP41C, while taking care of the direction. Another same type of diode is placed between the pin 2 and 3 of the TIP42C, but this time the direction is opposite. Let's take a closer look at the progress. The components are placed, now the connections are needed. The orange wire's one end is connected to the positive power supply. The other end is connected to the pin 3 of the TIP42C. The black wire's one end is placed at the negative supply voltage and the other end to the pin 3 of the TIP41C. I place two gray wires to the pin 4 of the TDA2030A and connect the other ends to the TIP41C and TIP42C's pin 2. Earlier, I've connected the diodes only to the pin 2 at both transistors, so now I connect back the diodes with two gray wires to the pin 3 at both transistors according to the schematic. Next, I place a blue wire, which will be the output, and a gray wire, which will be the output ground. With a small gray wire, the power ground and the signal ground is connected. Another small wire with green color is placed, which connects the TDA2030A's pin 3 to the TIP41C's pin 1. The input jack is placed and the circuit is finished. But before an input signal source or output load is connected, some measurements has to be done in order to be sure that the circuit works correctly. As you see, the output is measured without the load connected. It has a small negative voltage bias after I've turned off the power supply, but slowly goes to the 0 volt. When I turn on the power supply again, the voltage jumps to 0 volts, so the circuit works. After a quick temperature test and measuring the input jack to see if everything is fine, it was time to connect the oscilloscope to do some measurements. I've noticed that the LED lights and supposedly the SMPS power supply of it generates noise. So when I turn it off, the sine wave becomes clean. As you can see, the amp is working pretty well for the first time. The shape of the sine wave is probably not perfect, but still better than expected. I've checked the heatsink of the TDA, but it was cool, so it was time to connect the load and stress test this circuit. After connecting a 4 ohm power resistor, a sine wave was fed to the circuit for a short time and I check again the heatsink to see if it got too hot, but looks like everything is fine. The highest output power the circuit could reach at this point was 4 watts. I've changed the 1k ohm resistor to a 470 ohm resistor from the gain setting resistor pairs to get higher gain. The other change made on the circuit was the 10 microfarad inverting input DC decoupling capacitor was replaced with a 22 microfarad capacitor to achieve better low frequency range. Doing more tests revealed that the transistors also need heatsink. The taps of the TIP41C and TIP42C are connected to the pin 2 at both transistors. The TDA2030A's tab is connected to pin 3, which is the negative supply, so if the negative supply voltage would reach the taps of the transistors, then something would get damaged. The TO220 isolators and bushings are the best solution, which help to isolate the taps from heatsink and prevent accidental short circuits. The transistors were fastened to the heatsink with M3 screws. I've made another measurement and this time the output power was around 4.4 watts. After placing bigger value capacitors to the power supply, the output power increased to 5.1 watts. Being unsatisfied with the results, I've decided to rebuild the whole circuit. The following changes were made. I've increased the capacitor values even more at the power supply from 4700 microfarad to 10,000 microfarad. The leg extensions of the TDA2030A were rearranged, so less connections were needed. The wires were changed to a shorter ones for better connections and less losses in the circuit. The grounding was also rearranged. Star grounding was implemented, which means that all the ground connections ends in one point, which can increase the stability and decrease oscillations and noises. It was time to do more measurements. This time the measurement showed a 4.72 volts RMS, which results a 5.5 watts of output to a 4 ohm load. I've doubled the wires at the supply lines on the breadboard and the output power increased even further. This time it was 5.12 volts RMS, 6.5 watts, which is a significant increase. Please note that the TDA2030A IC is fake, so probably that is the reason why it can't reach the output power values shown in the datasheet. When the output signal is turned way down, a notch can be noticed. This notch can be reduced by using good quality parts with exact values and a well-designed PCB. It was time to do some frequency sweep tests to measure the frequency response. First, the low frequency response was measured. This test was made with a sweep from 10 Hz to 100 Hz, and this circuit could go down to around 25 Hz without any major decrease in signal level. When the high frequency response was measured, using a sweep from 10 kHz to 22 kHz, a slight decrease in signal can be noticed starting from 13 kHz. This decrease of signal was probably from the low pass filter at the input of the amplifier or by the signal source, which was my phone in this case. This can be fixed by using lower resistor value at the filter, which increases the cutoff frequency, or using a proper signal generator. The last frequency sweep was from 100 Hz to 16 kHz. The response is really linear. The final power measurement was done after doing some minor tweaks. The RMS voltage was 5.2 volts, which means 6.7 watts of output. Last but not least, a power test with an 8 ohm load. The measurement showed around 6.3 volts RMS, which is 4.9 watts of output power to an 8 ohm load. I've also built a standalone circuit with only using the TDA2030A to compare the output power difference. This standalone circuit was capable to output 5.5 watts to 4 ohm load. This means that the circuit with the transistors has more than 15% higher output power. Here are some tips which can help you build this circuit. If you are new in amplifier circuit building or haven't built a TDA2030A based circuit, I recommend building first the simple amplifier circuit without the transistors. In the datasheet of the TDA2030A, on the figure 20, it is shown a diagram of a three-way amplifier circuit with active filters. I do not recommend this circuit because the power amplifier circuit should not include the filter, which can be found at the input part at each amplifier circuit. The filtering should be done in a separate stage before the power amplification using a preamp IC like the NE5532 or LM833. These would be dedicated to filter and then the TDA2030A would do the power amplification. Use capacitors as big as possible. High value capacitors like 10,000 microfarad can greatly increase the output power. Before ending the video, here is the final schematic for the circuit, which will be the source for the design of the PCB. You can find this schematic on my Facebook page, link in the description. Thank you for watching.